Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. A warm welcome to our Honourable President, Mr. Ramnath Kovind, to all the dignitaries on the dais, and to all of you who have taken the time to be with us this morning for this inauguration of the National Conference on Technology, Training and Infrastructure, Keys to Speedy Justice, and the Changing Face of Legal Education in India. This conference has been organized by the Supreme Court Advocates on Record Association, SCORA. It is my privilege to invite our president to kindly light the inaugural lamp, and I request all the dignitaries on the dais and members of the Executive Committee of SCORA to join in the ceremony. Thank you. Our thanks to the Honourable President for inaugurating this conference. And now I invite Mr. Shivaji M. Yadav, the President of the Supreme Court Advocates on Record Association, to deliver the welcome address. Mr. Yadav.
Thank you. Honorable the President of India, Sri Ramnath Kovindji, Honorable Chief Justice of India, Justice Deepak Mishra, respected Attorney General for India, Sri K.K. Venugopal, Honorable Mr. Justice Ranjan Gogoi, Honorable Mr. Justice Madan Lokur, Honorable Mr. Justice Korean Joseph, and Honorable sitting and former judges of the Supreme Court of India, Honorable Chief Justices and Honorable sitting and former judges of the High Courts, respected senior advocates, Mr. Prashant Kumar, Vice President, Mr. Snehasis Mukherjee, Secretary, members of the Executive Committee of the Supreme Court Advocates on Record Association, Sri Patta Joshi, Vice President, Sri Vikrant Yadav, Secretary, and members of the Executive Committee of SCBA, distinguished delegates, friends from the media, dear colleagues, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the Supreme Court Advocates on Record Association, it is my honor and privilege to extend a very warm welcome to Honorable the President of India, Sri Ramnath Kovindji, who has very kindly consented to inaugurate the first National Conference on Technology, Training and Infrastructure, Keys to Speedy Justice and the Changing Face of Legal Education in India, being organized by the association. It is indeed overwhelming to find that this significant step in the history of the association is being blessed by the august presence of Honorable President of India, who was one amongst us as an advocate on record. At a personal level, it is homecoming for the Honorable President of India. As for us, while welcoming you on behalf of the legal fraternity and the association, we are humbled that one amongst us today occupies the highest office of this country. He represents the sovereignty and integrity of the Republic of India and is the supreme commander of the defense forces of the nation. The Supreme Court Advocates on Record Association comprises of legal professionals who are conferred the status of advocate on record by the Supreme Court of India in accordance with the Supreme Court rules. This association has over the years been instrumental in asserting its voice on several issues of national importance, like appointment of judges and safeguarding the independence of judiciary. This association has always acted to uphold and maintain the constitutional values and the rule of law. This association is the settler in creating the Supreme Court Advocate on Record Welfare Trust, which provides a welfare scheme for advocates, their clerks and dependents, giving them free medical insurance. In the last few years, several thousand persons have benefited from this scheme. The present national conference is yet another step of the association towards development of law and lawyers' scholastic aptitude. Our association has consciously chosen the topics of technology, training and infrastructure, keys to speedy justice and the changing face of legal education in India, keeping in mind the prevalent role of technology, the increasing need of training and infrastructure, and the seemingly ever-evasive goal of speedy justice. Further, with increased education and legal literacy, the coming up of several national law schools and the availability of electronic research engines, the legal education of the day has undergone significant changes. According to a recent study, technology plays a major role in approximately 85% of the businesses that are emerging currently. However, despite the technological advancement and persistent overhauling of the legal education in India, the dichotomy and the challenges remain the same in the administration of justice. Desire for fair and affordable justice, juxtaposed with clearing the backlog of cases, is a Herculean task. Besides, the nature of disputes in a globalized and heavily digitalized world has brought about newer challenges to the justice delivery system. No doubt, alternate dispute resolution mechanisms have been a welcome relief, and so is the introduction of e-filings, video conferencing, and use of platforms like WhatsApp, etc., for facilitating effective summons. These are undoubtedly small and simple, but most definitely effective reformative steps. The Supreme Court E-Committee, under the chairmanship of Honorable Justice Madan Lokur, that was formed a few months ago, needs to be commended for its endeavors to monitor use of technology and administrative reforms in the Indian judiciary. Similarly, in the field of legal education, mere establishment of national law schools does not guarantee quality lawyers, but the field must be nurtured consistently and comprehensively. We must ensure that our universities preserve and produce the finest of legal brains. We must also ensure that, in pursuit of our professional obligations, training a lawyer must also be accompanied by intellectual, economic, and moral support by we, the seniors in the bar. It is also important that the appointment of faculties, directors, and vice chancellors must be devoid of any extraneous considerations. Taking a cue from universities worldwide, legal education, as imparted, must be pragmatic and more specialized. Also, the retired judges and judicial officers are valuable assets, seasoned with courtroom experience, and can be wonderful resource personnel for training the younger minds. While the National Judicial Academy at Bhopal is an illustrious institution, round-the-year workshops and seminars at different courts in an institutionalized training mechanism module shall ensure effective training for better adjudication of matters. I, on behalf of the Supreme Court Advocates on Record Association, would also like to avail this platform to express some of our concerns before this noble gathering. Working at ground level, we the advocates face the challenges of judicial vacancies day in and day out, and it is often observed by us that if only the appointments of the judges could be made promptly and well in advance, and if basic infrastructure requirements like chamber space, residential space, conference and parking areas are increased, a good share of agony could be minimized for the members of the bar. This August gathering today shall witness several expert speakers and resourceful personnel to deliberate upon the finer aspects of the aforesaid themes. And I'm extremely hopeful that this intellectual exercise shall bring more prudence to our practice. I must also convey this impressive gathering about the release of the SCORA e-journal, which would yet again be an extension of the legal and intellectual deliberations and a platform for free exchange of ideas. A proud moment to celebrate freedom of speech we so ferociously protect in our courtroom decorum. With this, I once again welcome each one of you to the inauguration of this conference and hope it shall achieve the desired result of learning plethora of ideas. Thank you.
I thank Mr. Shivaji Jadhav, President of the Supreme Court Advocates on Record Association, for his thoughts, his ideas, his aspirations, and his hopes. May they all come true. Thank you, Mr. Jadhav. We would now like to felicitate the Honorable President of India, Mr. Ramnath Kovind, to express our happiness and pleasure at his being with us here today. I request Mr. Shivaji M. Jadhav, President of SCORA, to kindly do the honors. And now I request Mr. Shivaji Jadhav to felicitate the Honorable Chief Justice of India, Mr. Deepak Mishra. We would like to felicitate Honorable Justice Ranjan Gogoi, and I request Mr. Snehashish Mukherjee, Secretary of the Supreme Court Advocates on Record Association, to present the memento. And now, ladies and gentlemen, we wish to felicitate Honorable Justice Madan Bhimrao Lokur. The President of SCORA, Mr. Shivaji Jadhav, will do the honors. And our warm felicitations to Honorable Justice Kurian Joseph. Mr. Snehashish Mukherjee, kindly do the honors. Thank you. And we are happy to felicitate our learned Attorney General of India, Mr. K.K. Venugopal. Mr. Snehashish Mukherjee, kindly do the honors. And now, ladies and gentlemen, I request the Honorable Chief Justice of India, Mr. Deepak Mishra, to release the SCORA e-journal and to present the first copy to the President of India. That's the first copy of the SCORA e-journal. Ladies and gentlemen, it is now my pleasure to invite Mr. K.K. Venugopal, Attorney General of India, to kindly address us.
Honorable President of India, Sri Ramnath Kovind, Honorable Chief Justice of India, Chief Justice Deepak Mishra, Sri Shivaji Yadav, President of SCORA, and his office bearers, Honorable Judges of the Supreme Court, on the dais and off the dais, present and former, my colleagues at the bar, and ladies and gentlemen. It's indeed an honor to be invited by SCORA to be present at this function. It is indeed a greater honor to be able to share the dais with the President of India. The topics which are going to be discussed at this seminar include also the change in legal education over the course of years. And I believe that perhaps I am best suited to speak about this topic because I joined the law course in the year 1951, which is about 67 years back. And you would not believe it that so far as today, when I look at what is being taught, the method of teaching, and the various aspects of the national law schools and the colleges, they are worlds apart. We had no moot court, we had no laptops, we had no Wi-Fi, we had no seminars, and all that we had was what one would call dukis. And dukis, I don't know whether they are in fashion even now, but dukis are small 60 pages books where Saman and Jurisprudence, 200 pages, is reduced into 60 pages. But believe me, if you studied those dukis, you would get, you'd pass with flying colors. But today when you go to the national law schools, the law colleges, you find there are subjects which I never heard of at that time. India has been progressing industrially, economically, and socially. And we have, therefore, to keep in touch with the developments in other countries. Therefore, we have international arbitration, we have international investment law, we have WTO, competition law, and double taxation laws, then treaties double taxation investments, and so on. Now, you find the students sitting with laptops in the lawns. That is because the entire campus is Wi-Fi. And therefore, they are able to access internet, and they have vast databases. And with those databases, they are able to follow the judgments delivered in any part of the world. Now, this is something which has totally changed. And therefore, I believe that at those days, a lawyer took a considerable amount of time for the purpose of being able to stand on his legs and address the courts, 10 years sometimes. Till then, he was a junior following this senior around the courts and perhaps asking for adjournments and nothing more than that. But today I find, I've seen in the Delhi High Court, even the Supreme Court, I find young lawyers graduating, and within the next few days, they'll be standing and addressing the court with great confidence. And what is more surprising, and one has to appreciate that, the women lawyers are equally competent, and there seem to be as many women lawyers as men lawyers. Now, this is indeed a total change from the manner in which law was being practiced and their young lawyers will be able to get come up. But with all these positive characters, one has to characteristics, one has also to point out that if in Delhi a lawyer wanted a rented premises for his residence or office, he would not find a landlord who would be prepared to give him that. But one need not feel that Delhi is different, because even in Japan, a lawyer asking for premises for his office would be denied. That is because there is also, unfortunately, side by side, a lack of trust in lawyers. And therefore, that is an aspect of which we have to get over. We are an honorable profession, we were an honorable profession, and we should continue to be an honorable profession. And therefore, my plea, a genuine and sincere plea, is please don't go on strikes. Strikes are intended only for trade unions. It is true that today a survey which has been carried out worldwide says that so far as the legal profession is concerned, it has become a drastically competitive business. We are not in a business. We are in an honorable profession. And therefore, I hope that so far as we, the bar in India, is concerned, it would be able to hold its hand heads high as being as good and better than any other bar in the world. Thank you.
We thank our Attorney General, Mr. K.K. Venugopal, who moves with the times, ladies and gentlemen. And with your guidance and your inspiration, I'm sure SCARA can do much in the future, starting with this national conference. Thank you, Mr. Venugopal. I now invite the Honorable Chief Justice of India, Mr. Deepak Mishra, to deliver his address.
His Excellency, Sri Ramnath Kovind, Honorable the President of India, my esteemed colleagues, Honorable Justice Ranjan Gogoi, Honorable Mr. Justice Madan B. Lokur, Honorable Justice Kurian Joseph, Mr. K.K. Venugopal, Attorney General for India, Mr. Sivaji M. Yadav, President of the Supreme Court, Advocates on Record Association, office bearers and executive members of the Supreme Court Advocates on Record Association, my esteemed colleagues on the bench who are in the audience, former judges of the Supreme Court of India, Mr. Soli Sorabji, one of the eminent senior lawyers present here, other senior advocates, young friends from the bar, young judges who are present in the balcony and elsewhere, I mean the young students, friends from the electronic and print media, ladies and gentlemen. I deem it a great privilege to preside over the National Conference on Technology, Training and Infrastructure, Key to Speedy Justice, and the changing face of legal education in India, which has been organized by the Supreme Court Advocates on Record Association. Given the contour of this conference, I would first address the gathering regarding the tripartite structure of speedy justice, which involves the advanced use of technology, planned training programs, and investment in infrastructure, and thereafter I shall move to speak on the changing dimensions of legal education in our country. Before I proceed to focus on these two aspects, I would like to advance the two concepts the Honorable Attorney General for India has projected before you. First, he said, a time has come, or a time has arrived, where the young lawyers, without much tenure of practice, are competently addressing the court. I would like to add, young lawyers, both ladies and gentlemen, if they are not allowed, once they are technologically sound, as far as the law is concerned, I think the old should leave the room for them. They should be allowed to argue, allowed to speak. The second idea, I would like to say, once you are technologically sound and you are in this noble profession, fundamentally, to borrow a phrase from an English writer, you are on the path of noble Romans. Noble Romans with law is nobility, and that is why you are here. The London Attorney General has suggested that the bar should not go on strike. And the London Attorney General for India, as far as the Constitution is concerned, he is the leader of the bar. I would only request, when the leader of the bar has requested, treat it as a command, apart from the decision in the Constitution bench. Let's go back to the topic. With the advent of globalization, the influence of technology has become ingrained in every sector of modern society. Technology has not only accelerated the growth rate in various service industries, but also generated increased social awareness and made citizens more informed than earlier to claim their rightful entitlements. This has resulted in the creation of an informed citizenry who are more vigilant and cautious of their rights against any form of exploitation by the organs of the states. With such transformation of the citizenry, it has become imperative for the legal fraternity to respond more proactively in discharge of their functions. This principally involves use of technology in pushing for necessary administrative reforms in judiciary for promoting speedy justice to all. Technology has acted as a catalyst for boosting our productivity, quality, and performance. This makes technology a three-pronged beneficial tool for us. Firstly, we can use technological resource to strengthen our managerial and operational support. This would mean that internal administration of the court's registry and its work can be made easier by employing appropriate technology like scanning and copying of case files, preparing docket status report, and allotment of cases. Secondly, technology can enhance quality of our work by acting as an aid in expediting the routine cases, especially in cases where criminal in nature, where testimony and evidence can be recorded by videotapes. To this extent, Indian courts have already been making use of technology for recording evidence in a number of cases. E-Courts project has also been a step in this direction. Thirdly, technological resources like legal database can aid in strengthening the judicial research. And I have always said, research means research. When you copy from one website, someone will say it's plagiarism. And ladies and gentlemen, when you copy from 10 sources, somebody will call it research. Do not be deceived by this. That's not research. Research must have a database plus original analysis by your scanner. When I say your scanner, I mean your own neuro scanner. A striking example which bears testimony to the efficient utilization of technology by the judiciary is the establishment of the e-court of the e-committee of the Supreme Court way back in 2004 to work on computerization of Indian judiciary, to employ technology for strengthening our administrative capacities, to enhance our outreach to the consumers of justice, and also to generate series of management reforms in handling pendency and delays in courts. The legal profession, as I understand, has recognized the need for continuing education, for the study of law involves a lifelong learning process. With young law graduates entering the judiciary, it has become incumbent to impart training and conduct programs in order to equip the young appointees with necessary skills and knowledge to enable them to perform their role as judges. The skill building is an art, and technology, as a matter of science, sustains this art. Unless you are a skilled architect today in law, I'm sorry to say, you will witness a sorrowful tomorrow. The suggestion is to you, remain in constant nowness. Constant nowness is progress. Do not be conservative in these ideas. Walk with the pace of modernism. Living in the glorious past, with regard to your own ideas, which you had fostered in your youth, I'm talking about the elder generation today, it will not be treated with respect. You must march with the eye of time, and today is the time for technology. I say so because the technology is now getting connected with access to justice, which is being treated as a part of fundamental rights in a different way. The majority of the population, being not aware, cannot avail the said facility of access to justice. Therefore, judicial training, apart from focusing on imparting knowledge and practical skills, must also give due emphasis on sensitizing the new aspirants on the contemporary societal and economic issues prevailing in our country. That apart, it must impart skilled training to be sensitive to the legal awareness of the citizens. I talked about the judiciary, but what about the bar? Throughout the nation, various high courts, various bar associations representing the high court bars have conceived the idea of lawyers' academy. Some have become successful, some have not started. And therefore, a situation has to emerge where the lawyers must have their independent academy so that they can spread awareness as well as also sensitize the lawyers' technology in amalgamation with access to justice. Let me focus on infrastructure. I would like to emphasize that this remains a primary concern, for without adequate infrastructure development, we cannot realize our commitment to justice for all. We must work upon widening the network of courts in order to bring it within the geographical reach of a common man, to provide basic facilities for litigants and required facilities for the lawyers. I know lawyers present here are still demanding for chambers. I'm aware of it. It shall be dealt with. That may, to continue the sentence, for effective consultation. It helps the litigants as well as the lawyers. And to that I will add, when your consultation takes place, there is a mediation which must also get in. You can be a mediator before you enter into any kind of adversarial litigation. I do not intend to stress the idea, but the idea must be planted in your mindset. And therefore, I would like to emphatically put forth judicial infrastructure, which includes infrastructure for the bar and the litigants, is the backbone of justice delivery system. And justice delivery system is not an alien concept to the serviceability of the institution. And in this service, or in this rendering of service, the judges, the members of the bar, and the litigants have a say, maybe in different degrees. The infrastructural gaps shall not be allowed to multiply for long. We must plug these gaps at the earliest opportunity before they leave a deep scar on the administration of justice and it becomes too late to act wisely. It's certainly something for the administration. Fiscal constraint is no excuse. The need is to strengthen the judiciary, as a consequence of which the justice delivery system becomes fast, qualitatively responsive. I emphasize on the word qualitatively responsive and serve the cause of justice. I'm happy to note that the Supreme Court Advocates on Record Association has carefully picked up these issues involved in speedy dispensation of justice for this conference to make everyone more sensitive. We have the National Law School's 5-year courses, and they are guiding the younger generation on the proper, in the proper direction. These students who pass out from the colleges and join the chambers of the seniors or the corporate offices, or for that matter, our fraternity, the young as magistrates, I would not like to call them at any wrong in the judiciary, as magistrates, because they are the adjudicators at the primary level. They must equip themselves, apart from law, how to use the technology so that they can become techno-friendly and also make the litigants techno-friendly. I'm sure the exchange of ideas, sharing of experiences, deliberation on future roadmap in this conference will provide enough intellectual resource for the legal and judicial fraternity and the legal academia to plug the gaps in their spheres of work. This conference and its exercise must be seen from a holistic perspective. Hence the bar, the bench, and the legal academia would come together to collectively work towards building a network of quality lawyers, a cadre of well-trained judicial officers, and an intellectual pool of law professors, apart from, I may add with all the politeness at my command, as sensitive lawyers. The functions and duties of all this converge at a singular point of fulfilling a constitutional mandate to build a social order based on democratic values, human rights, constitutional morality, and the rule of law, securing to all the citizens justice, liberty, equality, and above all, dignity. I told you about the noble romance associated with the nobility of the profession. Before I conclude, I would like to quote lines from William A. Ward. These lines are, really thought-provoking. They read thus, I quote, "We must plan purposefully, prepare prayerfully, proceed positively, pursue persistently," unquote. Before I part, and before you think of clapping, I am sure this conference shall be a successful one. And the Advocates on Record Association and all of us must express our heartfelt gratitude to His Excellency to be here today to address us. Thank you.
So, ladies and gentlemen, march with the times. We thank the Honourable Chief Justice, Mr. Deepak Mishra, for his responsive and futuristic address. And 1.3 billion Indians await the response of this conference from our legal luminaries. And now, ladies and gentlemen, it is my proud privilege and pleasure to invite the Honourable President of India, Mr. Ramnath Kovind, to kindly address us.
Chief Justice of India, Justice Sri Deepak Mishra, Judges of the Supreme Court, Justice Sri Ranjan Gogoi, Justice Sri Madan B. Lokur, and Justice Sri Kurian Joseph, other judges and former judges present here, Attorney General of India, Sri K.K. Venugopal, President, Supreme Court Advocates on Record Association, Sri Shivaji Jadhav, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. I am happy to be here to inaugurate the national conference being organized by the Supreme Court Advocates on Record Association. As a former member of the legal fraternity and of this association, this is a homecoming for me. Advocates on Record have a proud tradition. As per the rules of the Supreme Court, they are the only legal professionals entitled to act and plead on behalf of a litigant before the Supreme Court of India. They attain this distinction by virtue of professional competence unavoidable circumstances. It has been observed that various governments and government agencies themselves are party to many. He referred identified tribunals have been merged to form 18 tribunals. This prevents overlapping of jurisdictions to aggrieved parties. These are only some of the measures that the government has taken. There are technology can be a great enabler of justice. A start was made in 2016 with the opening of. Since then, the idea of e-courts requires filing, digitalization of documents. And e-payment gateways, as well as the use of hardware and software in the disposal of cases. I am happy that this concept is gaining ground, and I appreciate the judiciary for taking a lead here. Innovations such as evening courts and family courts and the concerted efforts made in delivery of justice speedy, fast-track judgments in cases of sexual crimes against women are also noteworthy. On the pathway of government's Digital India initiative, the legal information that is LIMS has been introduced as an online mechanism to monitor and streamline court cases and to reduce the government's own litigation. To bring all stakeholders from ministries to advocates to claimants and others on the same platform. This will check delays and financial costs. So far, 2.6 lakh court cases have been placed on this platform. Implemented by the National Judicial Academy in Bhopal. disciplinary and integrated approach was required to rounded legal education. This resulted in the setting up of deemed universities where over a period of 5 years, a wide range of subjects are taught to prospective lawyers. These are not limited to law, but also cover the social sciences and aspects of natural sciences. The establishment of the deemed universities anticipated the emerging legal landscape. Demands from our advocates and legal professionals have changed dramatically in recent decades. As the Indian economy has opened up, business and trade law and technology law have come to acquire a new salience. Rejuvenation, including access to greater funding from private and innovative sources, should be a common endeavor. When it comes to private law schools of a certain stature, the Bar Council is recognizing them that deliberations in some manner help bring efficient and affordable justice closer to the weakest and most vulnerable among our fellow citizens. Let that be the test of your success. Thank you. Jai Hind.
Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in thanking our Honourable President for his time and his thoughtful words of encouragement and advice. SCORA is very proud that he accepted the invitation and came to us this morning. Mr. Snehashish Mukherjee.